Tonight, the world in mourning to mark the end of an era.
She's been my queen all my life.
We'll have the latest live from Buckingham Palace. The royals' last-minute rush to be at the Queen's side. Heartbreak for Prince Harry. The plans to honour the Queen swinging into action. Charles becomes king after decades in waiting. Victoria remembers the monarch who touched our hearts as the city lights up in tribute. And how the MCG will honour the Queen for the finals.
Live from Melbourne, 7 News with Peter Mitchell starts now.
Good evening. It was only 48 hours ago that we saw her beaming and performing her official duties. But tonight, the world is in mourning after the sudden death of Queen Elizabeth II. Her condition deteriorated rapidly overnight, leaving the royals to rush to be at her side at Balmoral Castle. As we go to air tonight, crowds and tributes are building at Buckingham Palace. And flags are flying at half-mast across Melbourne, Australia and the world to mark the end of her 70-year reign. Hugh Whitfeld begins our coverage.
A death confirmed by a traditional post at Buckingham Palace, first broken on social media for a wartime princess who survived to become a modern-day monarch. The Queen died peacefully at Balmoral this afternoon. The King and Queen Consort will remain at Balmoral this evening and will return to London tomorrow.
A few moments ago, Buckingham Palace announced the death of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
Breaking news from Scotland here at Balmoral, where Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II has passed away at the age of 96.
The Queen is dead. At 96, Elizabeth II is gone.
Flags lowered to half-mast, confirming the death of our longest reigning monarch. The Queen's two eldest children, Charles and Anne, were already in Scotland with her at Balmoral, where the 96-year-old was last night said to have been resting comfortably under medical supervision. In itself, an ominous announcement. A procession of senior royals then scrambled to be by her side. Prince William drove his uncles Andrew and Edward and the Countess of Wessex to join the rest of the family. Too late, though, to see their mother and grandmother before she died. Prince Harry also rushed to Balmoral alone, visibly upset, more than an hour after her death was announced to the world. Her 15th Prime Minister, appointed just 2 days ago, emerged from 10 Downing Street with her first breaking news address to the nation.
We are all devastated by the news that we have just heard from Balmoral. The death of Her Majesty the Queen is a huge shock to the nation and to the world. It is a day of great loss, but Queen Elizabeth II leaves a great legacy. Today the crown passes, as it has done for more than 1,000 years, to our new monarch, our new head of state, His Majesty King Charles III. With the King's family, we mourn the loss of his mother. And as we mourn, we must come together as a people to support him, to help him bear the awesome responsibility that he now carries for us all. The passing of the second Elizabethan age, we usher in a new era in the magnificent history of our great country, exactly as Her Majesty would have wished, by saying the words, God save the King.
His Majesty the King confirming he'll be known as Charles III, sharing his grief with his people. The death of my beloved mother, Her Majesty the Queen, is a moment of the greatest sadness for me and all members of my family. We mourn profoundly the passing of a cherished sovereign and a much-loved mother. I know her loss will be deeply felt throughout the country, the realms and the Commonwealth, and by countless people around the world. During this period of mourning and change, my family and I will be comforted and sustained by our knowledge of the respect and deep affection in which the Queen was so widely held.
Happy and glorious, long to reign over us, God save
As we saw 25 years ago with the death of Diana, thousands rushed to the royal palaces in London and Windsor to mourn together. Floral tributes already growing.
I just happened to be walking down here and I noticed the flag at half-mast, and that's the first I knew.
I can't really believe it, to be honest. I know she's getting older, but it's one of them things you never believe is going to happen.
She's a person we've always looked up to. It's just a sad day.
She pledged her life to this country, and she led in this country with great reverence and duty and respect and honour, and I just don't know if there would be another like her.
Australians went to bed fearing the worst, waking up to confirmation.
It is my solemn duty to inform you that Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II has passed away on the 8th of September 2022 at Balmoral in the United Kingdom. I have informed the Prime Minister, and the Australian Government will advise on arrangements for national mourning and other arrangements in the coming days.
There is comfort to be found in Her Majesty's own words: "Grief is the price we pay for love." This is a loss we feel deeply in Australia. Queen Elizabeth II is the only reigning monarch most of us have known, and the only one to ever visit Australia. And over the course of a remarkable seven decades, Her Majesty was a rare and reassuring constant amidst rapid change. Her life of faithful service will be remembered for centuries to come.
In America, an unprecedented mark of respect, President Joe Biden ordering flags be flown at half-mast for 10 days until the funeral.
I had the opportunity to meet her before she passed, and she was an incredibly gracious and decent woman. And the thoughts and prayers of the American people are with the people of the United Kingdom and the Commonwealth in their grief.
From the US to Europe,
Buckingham Palace,
it caught everyone out.
So here's the thing, the Inflation Reduction Act. Okay, all right, well, okay, so that's been confirmed. Okay, the royal family.
On the ground and in the air.
Very sad news that our Queen, Her Majesty the Queen Elizabeth II, has died.
A planet interrupted. From the US Open,
we'd like to pause to remember Queen Elizabeth II.
To the United Nations, Wall Street traders and singer Harry Styles.
Join me in a round of applause for 70 years of service.
It even interrupted a nagging war.
З глибоким сумом дізнався про смерть.
As Vladimir Putin sent wishes as well, and as Paris flicked the switch on a ghostly Eiffel Tower, elsewhere on Earth, they had other ideas. Brazil turned all British as the Empire State Building turned a very right royal. From world leaders.
She was one of my favorite people in the world, and I will miss her so.
Present and past.
We just got along very well. We had a good chemistry, and we just talked all night long.
To the biggest names on Earth who led tributes online: Elton John, Paul McCartney, Andrew Lloyd Webber, and many, many more. As Fleet Street did what Fleet Street does. The world united for a moment in time.
You know, it's very strange hearing King Charles, and you go, she's really gone. She's just been such a part of all our lives. She's been the most incredible queen. It's been the most glorious second Elizabethan era.
As news of her death was announced, rainbows appeared above Buckingham Palace and Windsor Castle. Perhaps a final goodbye after a lifetime of service.
Our Europe Bureau Chief Hugh Whitfeld is at Balmoral Castle in Scotland tonight. And Hugh, King Charles III and the royal family are tonight executing a long-term plan to honour Queen Elizabeth the way she wanted.
Peter, among King Charles's first duties as monarch, signing off on the plans that have been poured over for decades. Ceremonial proceedings that will span the breadth of the UK, marking the end of one reign and the beginning of a new reign. Buckingham Palace, as a short time ago, confirmed that a period of royal mourning will take place from now until 7 days after the Queen's funeral. At this stage, though, we don't have a date for the Queen's funeral. It's likely to be in 10 or 11 days' time. Her Majesty passed away here at Balmoral Castle. It is a place she adored. And right now, senior members of the royal family remain here in Scotland in mourning. Mitch.
Hugh Whitfield in Scotland, thank you. As we heard, the Queen's death has triggered 12 carefully planned days of mourning. She's being remembered as the reluctant royal, thrust onto the throne, but determined to do her duty to the end.
The final image of Her Majesty. A portrait of peace and poise. Queen Elizabeth II, beside a fire, standing to duty in her Balmoral home just days ago. At 96, unwell but working. It was to meet and bless the 15th Prime Minister of her 70-year reign. We know now just how ill she was, but duty to her people, as always, was put first. The longest-serving British monarch and Queen of Australia celebrated her record reign at a platinum jubilee party, 7 decades for the woman born a princess who ended a queen. Insiders say this date in June was the milestone she desperately wanted to reach. Absent, her husband and best friend, Prince Philip, who passed 17 months ago. No other monarch in British history reigned or lived or served as long. No other head of state travelled as far or met as many subjects.
And it's the end of a whole era. And it's an era which has lasted for longer than most people's lives.
Princess Elizabeth Alexandra Mary Windsor, born April 21st, 1926, was never expected to rule. But when her uncle, King Edward, fell for the American divorcee Wallace Simpson and abdicated for love over duty, Elizabeth's father took the throne.
George VI was proclaimed king.
Suddenly, Elizabeth, aged 11, was heiress to the crown. Elizabeth never went to school. She was busy learning on the job. Her early life was defined by the Second World War, where she served as an ambulance driver and mechanic.
Although she drives it with apparent composure, she had no experience of driving before she commenced her training.
And when it ended, VE Day, she slipped unnoticed out of Buckingham Palace to join the London crowds in celebration. On her 21st birthday, a landmark speech. In the same year, 1947, she announced her engagement to Royal Naval Officer Prince Philip of Greece and Denmark.
Our future Queen had found true love.
Their royal wedding in 1947, a burst of colour in the grey years after the war. Firstborn was Charles, followed by Anne. But life for the young parents would quickly change. The King developed lung cancer. Elizabeth took on more of his royal duties, including this trip to Australia. The airport farewell was the last time she would see him.
The tragic news reached Princess Elizabeth and her husband while in Kenya. And the new...
It was February 6, 1952. Elizabeth was proclaimed Queen at 25. Eighteen months later, Coronation Day.
Into the forecourt of the palace and through the gates comes the gilded coach, 2 centuries old, bearing the young queen to her crown.
She made her way to Westminster Abbey in a service that would be televised live, a radical decision for its time. 30 million people watched as Queen Elizabeth ascended the throne. She was 27. The ceremony also filmed in Technicolor for cinema audiences in countries with no television, like Australia.
As this day draws to its close, I know that my abiding memory of it will be not only the solemnity and beauty of the ceremony, but the inspiration of your loyalty and affection.
When you think how young the Queen was when suddenly my grandfather died, to be required to take on such an enormous task.
She met hundreds of world leaders who paid their respects through the years, at home and abroad.
Mr. President.
From the adoring...
I did but see her passing by, and yet I love her till I die.
To the not so much. Hers was a life filled with handshakes and royal waves. During her first Australia visit, 1954, she waved so much she needed injections for her arm. Those sometimes uncomfortable moments delivering comfort to those less fortunate.
Very scary.
Thank you. Very wicked.
But for most, this was the closest the public got.
Today is another landmark.
Her annual televised Christmas message.
Wherever you may be,
I want to wish you all a blessed Christmas.
Always in control as head of state, but so often in damage control as head of a family. Most difficult, the era after Charles and Diana's marriage, 1981. The joy surrounding the arrival of grandsons William and Harry, overshadowed in 1992 by the breakdown of the relationship. The divorce of the Queen's only daughter, Princess Anne, scandal with daughter-in-law, Sarah Ferguson, and the near destruction of historic Windsor Castle. It led the Queen to declare...
It has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
Another horrible year for the royals, 1997. The car crash which killed Diana also had the monarchy fighting for survival.
I think when Diana died, it was definitely the low point of her reign. She wasn't strong enough. She should have tackled it sooner.
The Queen bitterly criticised for her handling of the tragedy, but it forced a moment in British history.
Mum, take care of the boys. Take care of the boys, Mum.
The people commanding the monarch to act, and she did.
What I say to you now, as your Queen and as a grandmother, I say from my heart. First, I want to pay tribute to Diana myself. She was an exceptional and gifted human being.
Then, in 2002, a double blow. The Queen lost her mother and her sister, Margaret, within a month.
It was really only after the Queen Mother died that the affection of the nation was sort of transferred, and she grew then considerably in stature in those last years.
The world did fall in love with the monarchy once more, with the Prince William-Kate Middleton marriage 2011. 7 years later, the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. With each union, the Queen's pool of great-grandchildren grew further.
Ow, it's my foot you're standing on. Yep.
But the two families would follow very separate paths. The future king embraced the one set by his grandmother.
Growing up, having this figurehead, having the stability above me has been incredible. I've been able to explore, understand, slightly carve my own path.
She's been very generous and not sort of being forceful at all in any of her views, but she's just, I feel she's been there as sort of a gentle guidance really for me.
But for Harry, a radical, seismic shift sideways to Megxit.
Did you blindside the Queen?
No. I've never blindsided my grandmother. I have too much respect for her.
Harry and Meghan fleeing to America, severing royal ties, blaming their problems on the Queen herself, even forcing the palace to defend claims of racism.
Conversations about how dark his skin might be when he's born.
The blue blood family left red-faced again.
It was definitely the wrong thing to do.
With claims of Prince Andrew's links with Jeffrey Epstein's sex abuse scandal. But perhaps most difficult of all, and in the middle of it all, the death of Prince Philip. He was 2 months shy of his 100th birthday. The Queen had never looked more alone, separated from family by COVID and from him after 73 years, the longest marriage in British royal history.
He has quite simply been my strength and stay all these years.
She described it privately as leaving a huge void in her life. Elizabeth was possibly the world's most private public figure. No woman was more famous, yet we knew so little about her.
It's inevitable that I should seem a rather remote figure to many of you.
But we occasionally had insight to her life loves, corgis.
Come on.
And horses.
Horses and Spunter. They love her. It's a two-way relationship. They both love each other.
This is a prima donna. I don't know whether you noticed her looking at you. Much as to say, do I look all right? Here's a funny pony. Spits it out again.
She has that wonderful smile, which, you know, lights up her whole face, and you can see the real joy she gets from it.
She loves not only riding them, but backing them. Racing was a passion. Until COVID interrupted last year, the Queen had attended every Royal Ascot since 1945.
Moore has won for Her Majesty the Queen!
Even winning the prestigious Gold Cup. That rare public smile occasionally coupled with glimpses of her famously dry sense of humour.
Good evening, Mr. Bond.
Good evening, Your Majesty.
This sequence with 007, Daniel Craig, for the opening ceremony of the London Olympics, ending with her doubles jump from helicopter to hero's welcome. A sight gag, unheard of in royal history. The most memorable Bond girl yet. She's been described as cheeky, witty, compassionate, kind.
I keep mine in here.
And at other times, cold, aloof, and distant. But above everything, she was a constant, ever-present in British and Australian life.
It's the end of an era, the end of an age, and I think we probably feel that we won't see the like of her again.
Even through a pandemic, she worked. While many events were cancelled, the Queen made a permanent base at Windsor Castle.
We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
As her country emerged from lockdown, appearances returned. At 95, this was a rare sight, Her Majesty accepting the assistance of a walking stick, the first time she'd done so in public in 18 years. But soon after, she cancelled a trip to Northern Ireland, reluctantly accepting medical advice to rest. Then, news Queen Elizabeth had spent that night in hospital.
We none of us will live forever.
She was the longest serving female monarch in the history of the world.
Throughout all my life, and with all my heart, I shall strive to be worthy of your trust.
Her reign was the last connection to an era when Britannia ruled. Millions will mourn her loss and everything she represented. Chris Reason, 7 News.
And Sarah Greenalch is at Buckingham Palace tonight, where mourners are paying their respects to the Queen.
Peter, good evening. It was raining here when news broke of the Queen's death, and today there are still clouds overhead reflecting the mood of the people who are continuing to come here to lay flowers. The queues to reach the gates of Buckingham Palace, the Queen's official residence, grew throughout the night. And how is this amazing tribute? You couldn't get anything more London, really, than black taxi drivers lining the Mall. In the coming hours, the bells at UK icons, Windsor Castle, Westminster Abbey and St Paul's Cathedral Will toll, there will also be gun salutes at Hyde Park and the Tower of London. While Charles is already officially the monarch, tomorrow he will be proclaimed. Today, we understand that King Charles and Queen Consort Camilla will travel from Balmoral back here to London to have an audience with Britain's new Prime Minister, Liz Truss. The UK's House of Commons will also meet so that MPs can pay their own tributes to the Queen. And then this evening, we understand that we will hear from King Charles for the first time in a televised speech to the nation before he embarks on a tour of the other countries that make up this United Kingdom, his first tour as their new leader. Peter?
Sarah Greenalch outside Buckingham Palace. And the AFL will pay tribute to the Queen in a semi-final to remember at the MCG. Tim Watson is there this evening, and Tim, the flags are at half-mast.
They are, Mitch, and the crowd will observe a minute's silence before the Demons take on the Lions here at the MCG. Players have arrived for tonight's game as the league issued a statement extending sympathies to the royal family. There'll be a minute's silence tonight and at tomorrow's semi-final between the Pies and Fremantle. This weekend's AFLW and VFL games will follow suit. We're expecting a crowd here of around 60,000 tonight. At this stage, the AFL is monitoring plans for the Queen's funeral too. It could be happening at the same time as the Brownlow medal count on September 19. The league is yet to announce, though, what it will do if that is the case. Mitch?
We'll see you a bit later on. Thank you, Tim. Victorians are paying their own tributes to the Queen. Jodie Lee has details.
Mitch, they're paying their respects any way they can. And next week, they'll have the chance to remember here at Government House.
Also coming up, how Geelong helped shape Charles and why he'll be different as King. And later, from stamps to coins and titles, the changes set to flow from the end of an era.
Saturday brings lots of showers, then it improves on Sunday. I'll have the full weather outlook later in 7 News.
Seven News, brought to you by Snooze.
Go to your room. It's a negative little phrase, but if your room's done right, going there couldn't be more positive. It can give you the best sleep ever. Ignite your imagination. Rekindle the spark. And help you escape. Let Snooze help you get more out of your room. Because the more amazing your room is, the more amazing you'll feel.
King Charles is promising a transition to a new era in the monarchy following the death of his mother. The Queen's passing has triggered royal changes not seen for 70 years.
7 decades as first in line, but always guided by his Queen.
My Lord, pray be seated.
King Charles says he'll be different from Prince Charles.
I'm not that stupid. I do realise that it is a separate exercise being sovereign.
Charles will be formally proclaimed King Charles III and wife Camilla known as Queen Consort. Prince William and Kate have already taken Charles and Camilla's former title and are now known as the Duke and Duchess of Cornwall and Cambridge. William, now the royal heir, will take on his father's former role as Prince of Wales, and like William's mother Diana, Kate will become the Princess of Wales. Born in Buckingham Palace in 1948, the first child of Princess Elizabeth and the Duke of Edinburgh, Charles Philip Arthur George Mountbatten-Windsor entered the world carrying the weight of royal expectation. When his grandfather, King George, died and his mother ascended to the throne, Charles became heir apparent at just 3 years old.
Prince Charles, the 17-year-old heir to the throne, arrives in Sydney on his way to attend school at Timberton.
By age 17, the heir spent 2 terms at the remote Victoria campus of Geelong Grammar before returning home to study for what would become an almost lifetime role, the longest-serving Prince of Wales in history, Charles delivering part of his speech in Welsh.
Mae'ch yn eichiad wedi fy nghyffwrdd yn dywys.
at the Britannia Royal Naval College, the start of a new training course for Prince Charles.
In the 70s, Charles served in the Navy and Royal Air Force, qualifying as a jet pilot. After 5 years, he left the forces, using his modest service pension to set up a charity, the Prince's Trust. Now, more than 50 years later, the Trust is estimated to have helped more than a million young people to retrain or start new careers.
Like with the Prince's Trust, so much of that investment is being repaid in spades, I think, in terms of the difference it's made to people's lives.
In 1981, 750 million people watched as Diana walked down the aisle to become his wife and princess. The following year, the young couple welcomed firstborn William.
And Princess Diana smiling, looking simply radiant.
The then second king-in-waiting was introduced to the world.
Prince Henry made his first public appearance.
But dark days followed and the marriage ended.
It became irretrievably broken down.
Yes, I adored him. Yes, I was in love with him. But I was very let down.
Diana died almost a year to the day their divorce was finalised. Charles and his boys, in a show of love and unity, watched by the world. In the late 90s, after years together behind closed doors, Prince Charles and Camilla were finally able to present a united front in public. The couple married in 2005 in a low-key civil ceremony in Windsor, some 35 years after they first met. The new king has spent his life championing causes close to his heart, advocating publicly for youth employment, sustainability, and climate change awareness.
We could no longer go on like this, as if there was no tomorrow and no ultimate reckoning for our abuse of nature.
In recent years, Charles has even managed to smile through some of his darkest times. He bounced back after catching coronavirus at the age of 71, displayed a stiff upper lip, thanking well wishers after his father's death.
We are, my family, deeply grateful for all that. It will sustain us in this particular loss and at this particularly sad time.
Now, as his family and kingdom bear another great loss, they will be led by a new monarch after a lifetime preparing. In London, Sarah Greenoch, 7 News.
One change that takes effect immediately, senior lawyers are no longer QCs. The Bar Association says Queen's Counsel are now known as King's Counsel. There are more than 6,000 barristers in Australia. It's one of many changes coming to our daily lives. Victorians are paying their respects to Queen Elizabeth. Jodie Lee is at Government House this evening. Jodie, there's a growing floral tribute.
Mitch, so many Victorians have fond personal memories of the Queen's time here, and they're just looking to reach out in some way. They've turned here to Government House as a kind of unofficial place of mourning the monarch in Melbourne, and tonight those floral tributes continue to grow. The People's Queen visited the state of Victoria many times throughout her reign, and by all accounts she showed an immense interest in matters of this state. From next week, the people of Victoria will be able to repay those affections and pay tribute to the Queen right here at Government House. There'll be an exhibit of artefacts and memorabilia commemorating Queen Elizabeth II and a condolence book for members of the Victorian public to sign. The news came early. Victorians trickling to the gates of Government House to pay a personal tribute to the People's Queen.
My lasting memories is how kind she is and considerate, and I love her.
I've never met her, and I regret very much that I hadn't or even seen her, so I feel a loss for that as well. I've never actually set eyes on her.
This man moved to song for a monarch he never knew.
The love that never falters, the love that pays the price.
For her to commission the British Prime Minister 2 days ago and then she's dead, if that doesn't fit the definition of commitment, and loyalty to country, I don't know what is.
From Linda Dessau, a white wreath, the first female Victorian governor to serve the crown, remembering a woman who gave 70 years of her life to service.
I think she genuinely loved her role and loved people and was interested in them.
The Premier and opposition leader among the first to sign a condolence book.
This is a very sad day, and in my lifetime, and for so many of us, this is the only monarch that we have known.
In Canberra, a booming final salute. 96 shots marking each year of an extraordinary life.
Today marks the end of an era, the close of the Second Elizabethan Age.
Queen Elizabeth II's reign spanned 16 Australian Prime Ministers.
All of us saw the Queen with enormous affection and respect, Republicans or monarchists.
Greens leader Adam Bandt roundly criticised, conveying his thoughts, then calling for a republic. The Prime Minister and his partner, Jodie Hayden, will represent Australia at the Queen's funeral before meeting the new king.
What an amazing life. What amazing leadership. And it is the end of an era.
And the beginning of a new one. Jodie Lee, 7 News.
It was a crime rampage in the heart of the city. Cassie Zervos has the details.
Mitch, it was 15 minutes of terror, 2 injured and 7 held at knife point. Live from Flinders Street, next on 7 News.
Also coming up, the law finally catches up with a Tinder swindler who ripped off Melbourne women looking for love. Why a heroic Victorian police officer is in trouble. And Australia Post sends an early warning on Christmas. A man accused of scamming AFL legend James Heard's family of more than $30,000 has been denied bail. Mark Burton is accused of posing as a tradesman and charging Tanya Heard almost 100 times what she should have been charged for work on the family's Toorak mansion. Burton was arrested at Melbourne Airport last month, trying to flee Australia. A heartbroken mother is promising to fight for safety upgrades on carnival rides following the death of her little boy. A coroner's inquest into the tragedy has been told an engineer had raised questions, but no action had been taken.
A heartbroken family fighting for change.
Eugene, we want you to know Mum and Dad are doing everything we can to bring you justice.
6-year-old Eugene died when he was flung from his favourite ride at the Rye Easter Carnival in 2017. He'd been permitted to ride the cha-cha with another child when he slid from his seat and hit the ground.
Losing a child is the ultimate loss, the worst trauma anyone can experience.
On the last day of a 2-week coronial inquest, ride owner Michael Whittingslow was grilled about his adherence to safety standards.
Did your staff know what they were doing that day?
The court hearing an engineer enlisted to inspect the rides in 2015 was left with serious concerns. None of the items listed for repair or upgrade in last year's inspection have been undertaken, and the rides were in worse condition than when inspected in 2014.
The court heard Mr. Whittingslow then hired a different safety inspector who he believed was good at his job. That's despite that inspector clearing a ride at the Royal Adelaide show that an 8-year-old girl later died on.
People should be entitled to go to fairs and shows and hop on amusement rides and feel that they're safe. Eugene's death should not be in vain, and hopefully the findings of the coroner will make sure that that doesn't happen.
Estelle Greepink, 7 News.
To finance news now, and the share market has finished the week on a high. Here's Network Finance Editor Gemma Acton.
Thanks, Peter. A solid Friday has propelled the ASX 200 to its highest close this month, up 47 points to 6,873. Miners led the way, with heavyweights including BHP and Rio Tinto driving the gains. The Aussie dollar has staged a sharp turnaround. It's now buying 68.4 US cents, while oil prices have also lifted up off recent lows. Back when Queen Elizabeth took the throne, Australian house prices were growing at their fastest pace ever. For 6 years following the end of World War II, house prices were capped. Once that cap was abolished, they soared by 172% between 1949 and 1954. That pace dwarfing even our most recent boom. Peter.
Gemma Acton reporting. Australia's coins will start to carry the face of King Charles as early as next year, but there won't be any quick change to the $5 note, the only one to feature Queen Elizabeth.
The milestones of her reign as Queen have been celebrated and commemorated.
There was this fascination with following every step of her life.
Stamps and coins, symbols of her sovereignty.
That's actually a very rare specimen note that's worth about $30,000.
Coveted by collectors.
There's nobody else in the public eye who has had such a long career, a long life.
She really is unique in terms of the visibility on those things that just, you know, appear in our everyday life.
Her presence destined to be enduring even after her passing.
We will continue to see coins and banknotes with Queen Elizabeth's image circulating. However, we will slowly start to see the introduction of Charles.
The Queen has been the face of Australian currency since 1966, but will soon be replaced by the new King as early as 2023. The Reserve Bank says there will be no immediate change to the $5 note, the late Queen and her son likely to circulate alongside each other, and as per royal tradition, they will be facing opposite directions.
Likely they'll hold a design competition for a new portrait of him.
Stamps to honour the Queen are likely to be released in time after the world has mourned, along with stamps of the new King.
One of the biggest stamp collections in the world was owned by the Queen herself. The collection features every stamp with her face on it, as well as her father's and grandfather's. It's now worth an estimated $170 million.
The term priceless gets bandied about a bit, and I think it's fair enough in respect of that collection.
Christy Mayer, 7 News.
Returning now to Tim Watson inside the MCG. And Tim, there could be a big change coming for the Brownlow medal.
That's right, Mitch. We'll have the exclusive details next, plus how the D's plan to stop Lachie Neale, along with the drama surrounding Joe Danaher's dash back home. Plus why a key cat was missing as Geelong eyes off a hit-and-run trade mission on a premiership rival. Also, how some sage advice from the Wizard could help the Dockers give the Magpies the finals heave-ho. And why world title number 8 is the best yet for an Aussie great.
This sport report is brought to you by PointsBet. Download the PointsBet app today.
Welcome back to the MCG. Less than an hour out now from Melbourne semi-final against Brisbane. Live to Chief Football Reporter Tom Brown. And Tom, you've got some exclusive details on the AFL's tribute to the Queen and how it's going to impact the Brownlow medal.
You know, I've just spoken to Gillon McLachlan, the AFL CEO, concerning tonight's arrangements and the Brownlow in regards to the Queen. Delta Goodrum will do a special version of the anthem. Obviously, the flags are at half-mast. The lights will dim temporarily. There'll be a minute and a half silence, and this is significant. God Save the Queen will play over the loudspeaker, at least a portion of it, and the AFL significantly will move the Brownlow to Sunday night if the official funeral is on the Monday. This was Gillon McLachlan just moments ago.
Yeah, it's certainly worth the discussion if the funeral is on the Monday night, same with the Brownlow, and we've looked at the contingencies. But again, I think let's just see before we make any announcements.
So the Brownlow Sunday night, if the funeral is on the Monday, moving of course to tonight's game. Now Joe Danaher is out. He's going to attend the birth of his baby. I can give you some background. He was in Melbourne this morning, Joe. The baby was scheduled to be delivered on Monday. It's come early. He kept it largely private from the club, he told some teammates last week. The other big issue tonight is whether they'll tag Lachie Neale.
I don't think there'll be any verbal, but it's a final, so it's going to be on.
Have you been approached by Essendon to be part of their setup?
Yeah, I have, and that will start next week, so I'll have an informal chat with them next week and see where that lands. Josh Marnie, obviously, he was a line coach here before, and I'm really confident with the way their footy club's set up.
And just finally, Tim, the Essendon field for their vacant coaching position is strengthening. I can report that Brad Scott is considering going for the job. Mindful, he's obviously the AFL footy boss, that if he keeps saying no to those senior opportunities, the fire still burns to senior coach and eventually they might run out. I think Essendon's been persistent in reaching out to Brad in the recent week or so, Tim.
Thanks, Tom. I'm joined now by Seven AFL commentator Brian Taylor, and Tom Brown was just talking about the loss of Joe Danaher tonight. Is that significant in your mind?
Well, it is when you add that to Oscar McInerney not playing the game as well. That's their two best tools gone, and that caused enormous problems for him. Fullerton come in, didn't do that well in the eight successive games that he played last week as well. So it is a real issue, height for them.
BT, last time they played in round 23, the Lions were bullied by the Demons. Can you see that happening again tonight?
I can a little, Tim. I'm thinking that's probably the process here tonight, but I tell you what they've got to do. They've got to get hold of Lachie Neale. If Richmond had got hold of Lachie Neale last time they played them, then they may well be here tonight.
Who would you send to Lachie Neale? I mean, that's a big question. He was in such magnificent form last Thursday night.
Well, Harms is the obvious one, isn't he? He's the one that they lose less from around the midfield. The trouble with it, if you send someone to Lachie Neale, like a James Harms, it then means that Brayshaw can't start in the middle, which he has in the last seven or eight games, and give them plenty of drive. So it's a bit of a catch-22.
Are you thinking the Melbourne side tonight?
I'm thinking Melbourne will probably have a pretty easy win tonight.
Okay, enjoy the commentary.
Thanks, Tim.
Brian Taylor there. A Geelong match winner was missing as the prelim final. Bound Cats sharpened their claws earlier today. Let's head to Mitch Cleary now with the exclusive details.
Well, Tim, star forward Jeremy Cameron was absent with that session with illness. The club insisting he will play next week against the winner of tonight. The Cats training for 2.5 hours at Deakin Uni to replicate the dimensions of the MCG. Patrick Dangerfield's elbow strapped after that Jack Ginnivan tackle. Tom Atkins was managed due to a heavy recent workload. Cam Guthrie not involved in tackling, dealing with his shoulder. Reece Stanley, the lead ruck, today and looks set to play. The Cats will be busy come trade time. Jacob Hopper choosing Richmond will allow them to go even harder at two locals. Collingwood's Ollie Henry and Giant Tanner Bruin both still out of contract. The Cats trying to lure them home. Up the highway today, the Pies and Dockers put through their final hitouts.
One of the game's sharpest shooters with a nod of approval from his coach, Craig McRae himself offering his finals experience, something the Pies will need every bit of tomorrow. Darcy Moore sitting out this morning's captain's run after a knee scare, but will play along with Jordan Ngoi. Dockers fans daring to dream. 7,000 expected at the MCG, including Jeff Farmer. The club legend today greeting former teammates David Mundy and Justin Longmuir.
Obviously they needed to get it on the scoreboard, take care of that and get the crowd out, and obviously, fingers crossed, we'll get plenty of Fremantle supporters along.
Michael Walters a watch with a calf concern. The Dockers preparing to be on the road for 17 days right through to the grand final.
We want to win a premiership at the end of the day, and we want to be the first group that have done it for Fremantle. So, if we were able to achieve that, would be, amazing.
Mitch Cleary, Seven News.
Australia's cricketers will pay their respects to the Queen with a minute's silence before Sunday's one-day match against New Zealand. The Aussies pulled off a stunning fight back with the ball to clinch the Chappell Hadley Trophy in Cairns. Adam Zampa claimed a career-best 5 for 35 as the Kiwis were bowled out for just 82. A trio of Melbourne Storm stars have taken pride of place in Richmond ahead of the NRL finals. While his mural was being painted on Swan Street, Jerome Hughes completed the Storm's final session as he battles a calf concern. The Storm take on Canberra in an elimination final tomorrow night at Amy Park. And an emotional Steph Gilmore has officially become our greatest ever surfer after claiming an eighth world title. Gilmore defeated American Carissa Moore in California to move past the great Lane Beachley. It's the 34-year-old's first world crown since 2018. What a performance that is. Mitch, I'll speak to you again shortly. Just a little bit of light rain falling here, but we're not expecting much.
Okay, thanks for that weather report. Thank you, Tim. We'll catch up with you a little later. Melbourne is marking the end of an era tonight. Next, see how the city is lighting up in memory of a monarch. That's coming up live from Flinders Street. And Operation London Bridge, planned step by step for years and now underway. Britain's final farewell revealed.
Thank you.
Governor-General David Hurley, the monarch's representative in Australia, has addressed the nation following the death of Queen Elizabeth.
Today we mourn the passing of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. The news of her passing, while we knew it to be inevitable, has still shocked, prompted reflection, and an outpouring of affection. What is clear is that even though her life has ended, her example to us all has not. That example of selfless service, devotion to duty, and compassion for others is both an enduring legacy and a gift to us all. When my phone rang at 1:38 in Adelaide this morning, I had a sense it was news that I desperately did not want to hear. Since then, millions of Australians, and indeed billions of people around the world, have been reflecting on Her Majesty's remarkable reign. In their reflections, many have recalled Her Majesty's own words and the seemingly impossible standard she set for herself almost 70 years ago at her coronation, when she said, "I have in sincerity pledged myself to your service, as so many of you are pledged to mine. Throughout all my life and with all my heart, I shall strive to be worthy of your trust." There can be no doubt that she met that commitment.
The Queen visited Victoria 12 times during her 70-year reign, greeted by huge crowds every time she endured unique local experiences like going to the footy and riding a tram.
Queen Elizabeth always had a special affinity for the state named after her great-grandmother. The feeling was mutual.
It was just absolutely amazing. It was the greatest thrill of my life. Wow. I'm still shaking.
Newspapers described her visit here in 1954, just months into her reign, as the greatest day in Melbourne's history. Specially decorated, Flinders Street Station, Swanston Street, Coles. A million people lined the streets.
It was just the most marvellous thing that ever happened. We were only getting glimpses, but it was such glamour.
In 1970, she went to the footy at the MCG, Fitzroy versus Richmond. Brownlow medalist Ross Smith had the job of explaining the rules.
With all respect to the Queen, it was just like talking to my mother, because she was about the same age as Mum at the time, and she was interested in the game. She was easy to talk to.
In 1973, Her Majesty returned to declare the Sydney Opera House open.
The Sydney Opera House has captured the imagination of the world.
At the MCG's 1977 centenary test, Dennis Lilly famously asked Her Majesty for an autograph.
But the request was turned down.
In 1992 in Canberra, Prime Minister Paul Keating broke the royal no-touching rule and was dubbed the Lizard of Oz. Back in Melbourne in 2006, at a pre-Commonwealth Games lunch, she ate local delicacy King George Whiting. Her speech thrilled the chef.
She said, "It's not very often that one eats a fish named after one's grandfather." And she looked over to us and she just smiled.
And that night, a landmark Melbourne moment.
"It now gives me the greatest pleasure to declare the 18th Commonwealth Games open."
After the 2009 Black Saturday fires, the then Premier visited her at Balmoral for a royal picnic.
"So it's time to clean up, so we all jump up, and Queen Elizabeth jumps up as well. So we're all stacking the plates and we're stacking the crockery."
In 2011, she went for a tram ride, Prince Philip impatient.
"Off we go."
Still, the driver that day says meeting the Queen was a career highlight.
"She didn't mind at all. She was just waving to everyone the whole time. You know, I could see through the mirror. She was just lovely."
Alex Coppel took iconic shots that day, but he and the official royal snapper jostled for position.
"Almost ended up in fisticuffs in front of the Queen on the tram, which wasn't ideal."
95-year-old Betty Ashton saw the Queen every time she was in Melbourne. Today, a sense of enormous loss.
"I really feel about her as though she's part of my family."
Nick McCallum, Seven News.
And the Queen also shared an affinity with the Australian public over her love of sport and our larrikin stars. From Lindsay Hassett to Michael Clarke, there was something about the Queen and cricket's rogues that just clicked.
A great moment for him to be presented to Her Majesty the Queen, Rodney Marsh.
Best known for her love of racing, the Queen was unable to wipe the grin from her face when Estimate rode to victory at Ascot. Jane Bunn is next with the forecast. And Jane, what's in store this weekend?
Well, Mitch, Saturday does look showery. Then we'll have a long dry spell on Sunday. I'll have the full outlook next. Hello again. Today there was lots of sunshine and slightly warmer northerly winds. It reached a top of 21. That's our warmest day since May the 15th. The September average is 17. It was still warmer than that at 6 o'clock tonight. Now it is 16. The afternoon brought showers around the Melbourne area, but not here. Now they are starting to come down off the ranges and in through the suburbs, but they're weakening as they do. Most will continue to remain completely dry. Western and northern Victoria were rather different. No more of yesterday's widespread heavy rain in the north. Today, it was generally hit and miss showers and thunderstorms. But there is a line of those thunderstorms that is now travelling through the northeast and a bit left over of this rain in East Gippsland today. While the heaviest rain has now eased, northern Victoria still has these flood warnings in place. The rain fell on already soaked ground, and this time it takes its time to work its way through the river systems. The King River is in moderate flood. The main low driving all the wet weather is well off the coast. Rain and thunderstorms continue to wrap around that low as long as it's with us, which does include tomorrow. Then there is a break on Sunday as the next cold front approaches. So the storms ease, but showers continue. Early tomorrow, they'll clear from the northwest of the state, only affecting the south and east. The weather now comes up from the southwest and not the north like we had today. So the air cools down. Melbourne is more than 5 degrees colder than we had today. We'll take a break on Sunday. It is dry for much of the time, but that approaching cold front has a band of showers tending to rain later, coming up later on Sunday and continuing on Monday. Now, this one's actually chilly. On Monday, Melbourne is almost 10 degrees colder than today, and there is alpine snow. Around the nation tomorrow, Brisbane back to dry weather, fog, then sunshine rising to 26. Just the odd shower in Sydney, mostly dry. It is dry, partly cloudy in Adelaide, 16. Lots of sunshine in Perth, 21. To Victoria, the northwest does look dry. Showers pass through the south and east. There's a change in the air. The south is cool to cold and mostly cloudy. The north cool with a mix of sun and cloud. Northwest to southwesterly winds. Closer in, there are showers passing through tomorrow. They are mainly over eastern suburbs. It is mostly dry in the west. They'll dry up during the afternoon. It should be all dry by tomorrow night. The city's heading for a top of 15, so that's 6 degrees cooler than we had today. Showers passing through during the day and all dry from about 5 p.m. onwards, so dry at the MCG tomorrow night. On the 8-day outlook, Sunday, it begins sunny, heading for a top of 17. Showers develop in the middle of the afternoon, tending to a period of rain, so great in the morning, but it turns after about 3 p.m. On Monday, just 13, lots of showers passing through, slowly recovering on Tuesday. Wednesday, lovely, ahead of a lot of wet weather. 15 tomorrow, there are showers passing through. It turns all dry by late in the day, so that makes it all ready for the footy at the MCG tomorrow night, Mitch.
That'll be great, but how about a roller coaster again?
Indeed, we're going up. We'll have some 19s down to 13, so we'll really feel that on Monday.
Thank you very much indeed, Jane. Now let's head back to Tim Watson at the MCG. And Tim, the AFL will pay its respects to the Queen before tonight's opening bounce.
Mitch, a crowd of around 60,000 is starting to build here for tonight's big game between the Demons and the Lions, this all-important semi-final. Both sides will observe a minute's silence before the national anthem shortly. Now, the winner of tonight's game will take on the Cats next Friday night here at the MCG for a spot in the grand final. That will be a sellout. Joe Danaher, that's the big news of the day. Joe Danaher, a late out for Brisbane. He flew back to Queensland this morning to be with his partner Adele for the birth of their first child. We wish them well. I just ran into the coach, Chris Fagan, a short time ago. He said family always comes first, but he said he would definitely love to have Joe out here tonight.
I'm sure he would. Tim, did you ever miss a final for the birth of one of your children?
No, I didn't. No, I didn't. I got very close to missing a game one night, but I got there just in time, Mitch. But the crowd is starting to build here at the MCG. Predominantly, it's going to be a Melbourne fan base here tonight, but pockets of Lions fans hoping it's going to be one of the great games that we saw last weekend.
And who do you like tonight, Tim, the Lions or the D's?
No, I think the Demons by a couple of goals, Mitch.
OK, Tim, thank you very much. And that's the way it is, this Friday, the 9th of September, the day we lost our Queen. Stay with us now as we head to the MCG. May Her Majesty rest in peace. Good night.